blessings as we gather today for worship. It would be sad if I didn't make a note for you watching who watch regularly that this is our last Sunday John Slice is doing our recording. We're going to try doing it with ourselves in-house because our recordings have become, well, a lot simpler, and John's talents, they're a lot better than what we need. So John, thank you so much for getting us through COVID and through all this time. And you'll be seeing some more of his work. Trust me, we're going to tap John Slice. But for now, this is our last Sunday worship that he is recording. Thank you, John, so much. Let us worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of our neighbors. Merciful God, you have called to all who thirst to come to you, to drink and eat freely of your love, and yet often we spend money for that which is not bread, we labor for that which does not satisfy. We see scarcity where you have given abundance for us and for all. Your prophets call us to maintain justice and to do what is right. We fear when the storms of life rage and doubt your presence and promise. We sink in doubt, and yet you reach out to save and give a place at your table of grace. Forgive us and restore us, O God. Your promise is that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Just as you in compassion fed your people bread, you feed us with grace and mercy. Just as there was food to spare, there is forgiveness to spare for all. Fear not, in the name of the one who is truly the Son of God, your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God, with all your faithful followers of every age, we praise you, the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation and form us into the body of your Son, that we may gladly minister to all the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Let us hear God's word. A reading from Isaiah. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion, he will comfort all her waste places, and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people, and give heed to me, my nation, for a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. For I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The gospel of the Lord. Well, we were talking to our friend James, who's a sophomore at Winthrop, and we told him the exciting news that we had when we were in Chicago visiting our son Samuel. We got to go to a concert at Wrigley Baseball Field, home of the Cubs, to hear none other than Bruce Springsteen. And he responded, "Who is that?" Way to make a guy feel old. Of course, I did first hear Bruce Springsteen 40 years ago, over 40 years ago, at Muhlenberg College when his Born to Run album came out. Let me tell you, that 71-year-old can play. He talked one time. He just played. It was great. I mentioned this to a few of you, so if you know the answer while you're watching this or whatever, guess what song of his, a big hit, he did not play. Born in the USA. Born in the USA was one of his biggest hits. Rolling Stones has it on its list of best songs of all time. The song addresses the economic hardships of Vietnam veterans upon their return home, juxtaposed ironically against a patriotic glorification of the nation's fighting forces. According to Wikipedia, quote, Born in the USA has been called one of the most misunderstood songs in history. It has been treated as a flag-waving pantheon to America by politicians reacting to the dominant tone of the song's chorus, without seeming to acknowledge the bitter critique of American policy and society present in the lyrics as a whole. The song presents a Vietnam veteran as a tragic figure alienated upon his return from the war, unquote. What goes on in the song is that there is a chorus that many of you could sing, Born in the USA, Born in the USA, that sounds very nationalistic and proud, but the verses in between the chorus voice a desperate narrative. There's a tension that is meant to inform the song's true meaning. It's about the Vietnam vet, yes, but much more so, it's about the social and economic siege on American blue-collar communities. To quote Springsteen himself about the song, he said, quote, that the working class man was facing a spiritual crisis in which man is left lost. It's like he has nothing left to tie him into society anymore. He's isolated from the government, isolated from his job, isolated from his family, to the point where nothing makes sense, end quote. The irony is that song is attacking blind nationalism, but it has been used for blind nationalism and to sell trucks and beer. The song has been stolen, if you will, the chorus used for something unintended. And maybe that's why I believe he did not play it. Well, is this something sometimes the case for the name of Jesus as well? For the title Christian? For someone saying, I believe in Jesus or I follow Jesus? What does it mean anymore for someone to have a cross hanging around their neck or tattooed on their arm? Has the meaning of the word Christ been co-opted like the chorus of Born in the USA? To sell America at times, to sell football, to sell a lifestyle, to judge others? Has it been co-opted by people on the left as well as on the right to say, look, this is what it means to be a Christian? Jesus asked his disciples and asked us, who do people say that I am? He is in an area, Caesarea Philippi, that, shall we say, was very, very Roman, with the Roman legion present, a Roman resort. It is as if he's standing beneath a statue or label or flag of others who claim authority and power, who claim to be the providers of peace. And he's asking, do you dare to answer in that shadow? Do we dare to answer in the shadow of nationalism, party politics, family dynamics, and more? If we're honest, we know that the name of Jesus, the name of Christ, has been co-opted and corrupted by people, even the church, for a long, long time. Who do people say that I am? Who does the church say Christ is? What would a Jewish person facing the Inquisition say that a Christian was? What would a Muslim facing the Crusades say? What would Native Americans have said facing so-called missionaries claiming their land? What might a poor person say in the shadow of wealth that people claim is God-given? What might victims of sexual abuse of whatever denomination say if it was covered up? At the same time, through all these times of history, the church and Christians were also active with acts of true compassion, of proclaiming the good news, of offering care, medical care, social care, and much more. There were those who sought to say something else about who God is about who Christ is, who has sought to tell people and show people a God of grace and love and of justice. Yes, there are other answers out there. There were other answers that those disciples knew about, and like good little students, they offered them up. It is Peter, bold, brash, boorish Peter, who speaks up and boldly proclaims, "You are the Messiah. You are the one we have been waiting for, the Son of the living God." There were, of course, many understandings and beliefs about what the Messiah would bring and do. Peter is still learning. He is not claiming to know all the answers. He just knows that through the power of God, not of his own, that Jesus is the one whom God has sent, that he is the one that he must follow, that he is the one who reveals God's true intentions for the world, for creation, for them. That is why they are told to tell no one, because they still have much to learn. They must still witness the cross and the empty grave. They must learn that the way of this Messiah is the way of sacrifice. And we do have the cross. We do have the empty grave. We know that when Jesus says the gates of hell shall not prevail against God's mission, the church's true witness, that that is exactly what happened. The cross could not prevail. Life prevails because he is the Son of the living God. God's church is built on the witness of all those from Peter on who speak of this living God in our presence. And Jesus goes on to give them direction as they seek out and show with their lives just who this Jesus is for the world. Jesus tells them that they have the power of forgiveness and reconciliation given to them by God to share or not. He tells them that whatever they bind on earth is bound in heaven, and whatever they lose on earth is loosed in heaven. Whatever they lose, whatever they forgive, whatever they let go is forgiven and forgotten and let go by God. There are those who might lick their chops over such a gift, a command, thinking that now I can tell those others just where they are going to spend eternity. Tell them what God thinks of them. Often people do this with a smile and a "God loves you" sticker. You know God loves you, but what if instead we let people loose with no ifs, ands, or buts? Even as people are challenged to live new lives in God, to be the people of God God desires, to show others just who this living God of grace is in our lives, to tell people that they can let go of their guilt or their shame, let go of their anger, and let go of any sin that holds them down. As I said, Springsteen's Born in the USA works as it's intended when we feel the tension, the disconnect between the rousing, patriotic sounding chorus and the difficult verses calling into question just such patriotism. Our lives are meant to be without such tension, without such disconnect. The praise we lift in church and in worship are to match the lives we live each and every day. Each and every day in all we say and do, we are answering the question, who is Christ to you? Who is the living Messiah in our midst? With our answers, indeed, we can help set people free for lives of grace and goodness. Thanks be to God. Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. God of Sarah and Abraham, inspire your church to pursue righteousness in its ministry. Equip us to share your compassion that unites us as one family of faith. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Remind us that from the beginning of creation, you knit together a world meant for harmony. Protect and restore the wasted places to joy and gladness. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Stir the leaders of nations and towns to respond to your teachings. Let your call for justice reach all people and bring deliverance where there is oppression. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Show your steadfast love and faithfulness to those in despair. Increase their strength, care for all who feel low. Keep safe any in the midst of trouble and protect vulnerable people from harm. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Encourage those who offer their gifts and talents in service to your church. Energize this congregation so they may be transformed in sharing your grace. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of all the saints, death is overcome in Christ's resurrection. We rejoice with the faithful departed. Sustain us in hope until we come at last to our heavenly home. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit guide you this day and forever. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.